Got us off there, Albie. Oh, shit.
Oh, yeah, man.
That's that whole Edward Van Halen.
Oh, and they ate one, too.
Yeah. Must have been hungry. Hello there, everybody.
What's going on?
This is the Britt and Phil show.
Yeah, and my name is Britton.
And I am Phil.
And
although it's Britt, he goes by Britt. We're not even a minute in. You've already fucked this up.
No, we didn't fuck it.
Yeah. Right,
well. Blah, blah.
Well, so I guess as a little intro, what we're trying to do here is just for my lifetime, every time I've gotten around my friend Britt here, whom you will learn many, many nicknames.
Oh, there are several. We're only getting the tip of the iceberg here.
I actually called you by your real name.
True. Very true.
So, my name's but I'm going to go by Phil just for shits and giggles, because...
More or less for insurance policy purposes.
And whatever. Okay. I don't want to cross the streams. This is what's going on with that. All my life, my friend Britt here has had just the most, and I know everyone says an eclectic taste in music, but very few people have I ever met that are actually, you know, eclectic in what they listen to. You know, come out here, like this week, what are you listening to?
Well, my latest obsession is the Van Hagar version of Van Halen. And the OU812 album, which of course was the introduction to this podcast you're listening to right now.
Yeah.
So
that was I figured to have Van Halen count us off was not a bad way to start. Also, another thing that I just want to do, just for frame of reference in the larger scheme of things, because I've told Brent about my four-dimensional music history graph idea, and we're gonna make that happen. By the way.
Oh, absolutely.
We're gonna make that.
I'm
happen.
All about it.
But what was I saying?
Talk about your four-dimensional musical.
Yeah,
philosophy
no, that was the subject. That was the aside.
Oh, that was the aside.
That was
okay.
The aside. But
well, we're getting back to
anyway,
my eclectic taste in music.
Eclectic taste in music. Yeah, Britt listens to everything all the time. It's one of my favorite things in life to come out here and ask him what it is he's listening to now. It's usually like one of the first three things out of my mouth.
I take pride in my listening abilities and searching of different kinds of music. I seem to be obsessed with more past than present artists of music, because I'm always forever discovering bands that I always knew of, but for whatever reason, I didn't either A, have the time, or B, take the interest, depending on the subjectivity of music in general is also another thing that I find intriguing, because... It's ultimately what you think is best. And I certainly don't have a problem offering my opinions.
Well, no, you never have. But I mean, they've always come from a place of like general music knowledge and like the accepted and the popular and the not so popular. Mm. And, you know, who's played on what with whom and in what year it was recorded and
right.
Produced and what studio did they record in. I mean, it's absolutely fucking ridiculous, the kind of shit that this kid knows. And yes, this is a for adult show. If you got your kid in the back seat, you know, put a headphone in, because we say fuck a lot.
Yeah, we do curse a little bit.
I say fuck a lot. I say fuck a lot.
We have to get the fucking point across. I mean,
that's true.
Know.
And I don't believe that can be done by limiting your language. And we fucking swear, so we're gonna swear.
Swear
very
to God.
Very much for the from the Kevin Smith school of fuck, fuck everything.
And again, you know, there is a Van Halen release right after OU812 called For Unlawful Carnal Knowledge, which, again, you put that into an anagram. No, it's not an anagram.
No,
what is it?
An anagram is when you use the letters that spell it out for some other word. There's
right.
No other word for fuck.
Right. And,
well,
and that's what the album is implied. Fuck. Because, you know, a lot more energy, but we're not going to get too deep into that part, but... Again, that's just kind of a slight relation to what the...
Right. So I was out drinking the other night, and like when I got here, OU812 was playing, and when it ended, we played it again.
Yes. And it was the fourth time that day that I just bought it at Rite Aid. They had it at the pharmacy right down the street, and I was like, because I actually remember seeing it the last week and thinking to myself, because it was for $6, and I'm like, should I? And I came back and I scoured to find it, and I found it, and I was like, yes. And as soon as I put it on with Mine All Mine opening up the album, I was just floored at the progressive tendencies of the music and just the absolute energy that the band was generating.
Yeah. A little bit of Mine All Mine here. Yeah, just... And yeah, and it like... Because I remember I told you at the time, we were in eighth grade when this came out.
Right.
I was... very much like when I heard this was coming out, I was very much into it because I really liked, like, I got into, you got me into Van Halen in
right.
fourth grade, 1984.
Right.
And then, of course, 5150 came out, and you're just like, but at that point, I was hooked.
Right.
So, like, I mean, you've come
around.
You
appreciated the Van Hagar.
Yeah, I really did, actually. I really liked the fact that Eddie was able to spread out as a musician, you know, because at the time, you know, I was just starting to play drums. I was really getting into it.
Right.
And it was one of those things where I wanted to, you know, just kind of see what was next, you know, because I mean, I really loved the previous two albums, even though they had completely different lead singers.
Right. Right.
Yeah.
Roth, you know, definitely was at the end of his tether with 1984. I mean, the egos got too big. He was kind of bound for a solo career, I think, anyway. Eddie was just tired of his crap, you know, alpha male personalities. Eddie's a little bit more of a slow brimming type.
So think of Van Halen as like a vagina.
Yeah.
There's only room enough in it for one penis.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Wasn't a
Diamond Dave, of course. You know.
Wasn't a porno vagina.
Yeah.
Is your average.
Although Eddie did contribute to a soft porn. He did contribute music about 10 years ago, I believe it was, or maybe 15 years ago, during a bait of their inactivity. And
got to make that money.
He did contribute music to a soft porn flick.
Got to make that money.
He did.
I'll got to compose a little.
You know,
64th note action here for Skinamax.
Hey, you know, if it pays the bills, man, you know, nothing wrong with that. But
yeah, if it pays the bills, you know, the bills. I mean, you know, we all do what we do because we expect something for doing it either in the long or the short term,
mm-hmm.
you know, something beneficial for ourselves. I mean, don't get me wrong. We all do things for our friends and family, you know, when we can. In fact, my good friend Britt here drove me over to sell my car this week.
I did.
Sold a car. I'm not giving them a plug because, you know, they did everything they could to chip the what they could off the price.
Mm.
Bastards. I knew they were going to do that, but...
It's still nice that you got more than what you thought.
It was a decent number. It was more than I was expecting. So.
Right.
That
was cool.
So, you know, but all that aside...
These are things that I do for my friend, you know?
Yeah.
So
he's a good fucker besides.
I try to be.
You are.
But anyway.
I'm gonna have to get your wife down here to talk about it.
Oh yeah, eventually she will.
Phil's microphone therapy.
Hang out in the background. Yeah, right. Hang out in the background. You know. Blah, blah, blah. She's down in New Orleans right now she's trying to have a good time, so I'm sure she is. It's a Halloween expo.
With another friend of mine, whom I'm planning on doing something like this with, my friend Laura Lynn.
Yeah.
Now, I'm changing my microphone here because I just want to hear when I listen back to this what the difference is.
Mm-hmm.
I might have to get a little closer.
Yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Because
according to my headphones, yes.
Because it's going to be a thing, and I'm just going to let the volume ride here. Just play the mic.
Okay. Would you like me to clip mine as well? Or just leave it where it is?
No, I want to do these one at a time so that we can get an idea. I really like the way you're sounding, though.
Yeah.
I don't want to fuck with that too much.
I think it sounds pretty good.
I think it sounds awesome.
Good position.
Yeah. That's what she said.
So right above the bun. You just have a little Andrew Dice Clay there, folks.
There'll be much Andrew Dice
Which
Clay
we'll be doing a lot of ad-libbing for that as well.
Basically, if you have thin skin, just turn the shit off now.
Yeah, you're not going to like it.
This is not for you.
Yep.
see ya. Some very opinionated people here.
Yeah.
We give zero fucks about how you feel.
Exactly. We all know who you are. We just want you to listen. That's all.
But meanwhile, back at the Van Halen Ranch.
Right.
We're discussing OU812.
OU812, yes. Yes, we're back on that. It's the second album with Sammy. I think they actually gel really well on this album. For whatever reason, back in those days, I kind of jumped this one. I skipped it. I don't know why I skipped it, because I had 5150 when it was new. And then when For Unlawful Carnal Knowledge came out in 91, I believe, a couple of years after AU812, I actually enjoyed that one. For whatever reason, is the only two Sammy albums that I really put stock in, but I was really taken aback. I had heard AU812 through you when it was new back in the day.
I loved when this album came out. This was all I listened to for like,
and I thought it was
three
good,
or 4 months.
But I wasn't a Van Halen. I mean, I go through so many phases with
him.
Come next week, I'm probably not even going to listen to it.
Goes through many a phase. Just go ahead and reach up and flip that thing on your mic. He goes through many
a phase.
Yeah, just one notch.
Okay.
He goes through many a phase, and it's.
Oh, I'm always switching around constantly switching.
Yeah, that's actually pretty good too.
So,
and you're not getting as much of the room.
Right.
A little more. A little less to compress. I think I like that one a little better, actually.
Okay.
And that's comfortable for you right there? Because that sounds good.
Yeah, yeah.
I can actually turn you up if that gets too bad.
That's totally
okay,
good.
So yeah. I'm going to go up there now, too, because I'd switched back in the middle of that.
Okay.
I'll know where, because I wanted to hear you talking in the room with both of those mics open like that.
Right.
So now we've got both of them kind of at the halfway point.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think it'll get any more weird than this.
Nah. But anyway,
pull this to me a little bit.
There you go.
So, that thing'll reach out. That's also why I have him on the opposite end of this table, so we don't break our fucking teeth out.
Yeah, exactly. Well, I fucking hit my head earlier, dude. I set up my headphones.
He went to scoot the chair up and smacked his face off the microphone.
Smacked me in the face. yes, sir. But anyway,
you'll also hear us mention the name of Friends. Sorry, guys, we're not making any money off of this, so you're not either.
Nah, not at all. But back to Van Hagar. This record has, you know, some real. I mean, Finish What You Started, you know, is one of the signature tunes. When It's Love, which is one of the few. And possibly maybe the only soft song on here, really, like more ballad-like or whatever, because 5150 had Dreams, it had, you know, Why Can't This Be Love, and then Love Walks In. So this kind of continues the trend here.
the commercial vibe.
The consistency here of love. The consistency of love.
You know something, it's something that's always kind of chapped my nuts that, you know, doing the whole love is a carrot on a stick thing.
But you know what? It sells.
It does sell.
You know, people
especially
enjoy it.
Like fucking teenage assholes
it
like me.
It gets played on the radio. I mean, you know, you got to make money. And if you're going to be, you know, especially if you're Van Halen. Because Van Halen, you know, they're not necessarily a singles. I didn't think they became more of a singles band until the passing of time. You know, by 1984 with Jump. It was kind of obvious that they were really starting to become more of a singles type of group. You know, I mean, of course, on their debut album, Running with the Devil and stuff like that. But I don't know if that was necessarily a really big hit single. I know You Really Got Me was. And of course, that was a cover of the Kinks hit single for them back in the mid-60s, but
I just pushed up the fader bar all the way there. I'm just making notes for myself here.
I mean, sorry. You know, of course they had Dance the Night Away from Van Halen 2, but I would say around the time of 1984, I mean, they did cover Dancing in the Street on Diver Down as well, so, and that was kind of a good hit for them, but it just seems that with the passing of time, after Dave left and Sammy came in, they really became more of a singles-oriented type of band. You know, we can also say after AU812 and For Unlawful Carnal Knowledge, Right Now became a huge single.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's an excellent number. It's probably one of the best ones they did with Sammy. Got a little overplayed for its day.
Yes, absolutely. And that's why I like, there's things off of OU812 that I think are way over. Like When It's Love.
When It's Love is,
I don't ever have to hear that song again in my life, because I've heard it enough times that if I want to hear it again, I just have to think about When It's Love and it'll just play in my brain. because it's that burnt, that etched into the gray matter.
Just like Dreams from 5150.
Yes. You know? Yeah, no, that it's the exact same thing. Know. Great song. Mm-hmm. Fantastic song.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I mean, when you hear it all day, every day for like about 4 or 5 years, it really takes the fucking wind out of it.
Gets old. Which is, you know, again, the subjectivity of music, but...
That's just commercial radio. That's all that is.
Some people, you know, don't have a problem ever hearing Stairway to Heaven. Other people... You know, it would be too soon for them if they never heard it again.
Yeah,
so,
I am of the latter group, you know. Because...
I gotta say, every once in a while, I will listen to it, and I still get goosebumps towards the end of the song, because it is a rather epic number. I mean, it is one of Led Zeppelin's most famous tracks, you know, just like Freebird is for Leonard Skinner, and Satisfaction for the Rolling Stones... You know, the Beatles, you know, Christ, the Beatles,
Hey Jude.
You could say Hey Jude, or you could say I Want to Hold Your Hand.
Yeah.
Depends on
what era
people consider.
I mean, you know, and if you're like me, I celebrate their entire catalog.
Yeah. Like Michael Bolton, you know.
Unlike Michael Bolton.
You must have a favorite song. must be really hard for you.
Yeah, I just love them all.
Those fudge packers. Of course, we're referencing Office Space here, folks, but yeah.
Some people just won't get it.
The two Bobs there, you know.
What are your names, Neil and Bob, or is that what you do?
But yeah, I mean, you know, with Sammy, I think... They kind of became...
Well, who was...
But they kind of ran their course, I think, with the singles bit, because on balance, there was only a few numbers that kind of hit. Of course, by that time, the climate of music was changing. Grunge was kind of ruling the charts back then. Hip-hop was also ruling the charts. So Van Halen's point, you know, by the time of Balance, which came out in 94, 95, you know, I think they were starting to become more dinosaur-esque. And, you know, a little bit dated, perhaps, you know.
And caught a bit under their own weight.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, you know.
Because at that point, I mean, you know, they're doing arenas and stadiums and just, you know, after, you know, a while of being with somebody on the road every day, you know, just you're in a bubble with them. You know, you're in the same everything. Yep. You're in the same room. You're in the same bus. You're on the same stage. You know, you're in the same hotel. I mean, you guys, you move in the bubble, you know, and it's. As someone who has traveled like that, I understand that after a while, you just need to get the fuck away from people.
Mm-hmm.
And it has nothing to do, it's just, you know, you reach a point of familiarity with some people that you just don't want.
Yeah.
You know? And that's, it's hard because at the same time, when you look at something like that in retrospect, you don't see all the horseshit. I mean, you remember it, obviously, but, like, mm-hmm. you look more fondly on the things where, you know, on the high points than the low.
Right.
You know, what is, you know, when you're in the slog, all you know is... being in the slog.
Yep.
And
absolutely.
And it can be tough. Well, back to the whole thing. Who was the producer on this album?
Well, actually, it's to my understanding, per the credits, that it was actually a band-produced record because it says specifically here, all songs written and performed by Eddie, Alex, Sammy, Mike, recorded by Don Landy, who's longtime engineer from the very first album with Ted Templeman. Ted Templeman, of course, as we know, stopped producing Van Halen after 1984 and David Lee Roth leaving because he actually went over and produced Roth's first full solo album.
What's Eat 'Em and Smile?
Which is Eat 'Em and Smile, yes. Came out in 86. So.
That's a point in time that I can look. I know exactly that, you know, 86, we were in sixth grade when that came out, on because that was like, that was when we first got MTV. We live in the fucking sticks, ladies and gentlemen.
Yep.
And that was when we first got MTV here. I remember traveling up to my grandmother's up in the Poconos and sitting at her place and watching MTV. The entire time we were there, they're like, what do you do? Get out from in front of the TV. I was like, I don't know if I have this shit at home.
Right.
I was just, you know.
Soaking it all in, man.
So the very next time we went up there, we took a whole bunch of VHS tapes and just ran them.
Right.
The entire time we were there. When one ran out, we just put another one in.
Yep.
And we just recorded a whole weekend and went home and was just like, that was my MTV for like a fucking, you know, for like 6 or 8 months until it finally hit the cable system around here.
Of course, back in the day, MTV was truly music television. That's when they really ran videos.
Eat 'Em and Smile was not long into the beginning of MTV, at least here.
Oh, no, it was definitely, I mean, I remember the video for Yankee Rose and...
No, wait a minute. I just remember that, well, that from a distance, that whole time is compressed. I guess that was actually a few years, because I remember seeing the video for Hot for Teacher, which came out in...
Oh, yeah, 1984. Well, I mean, of course, MTV began on the West Coast, if I'm not mistaken, on the West Coast in 1981.
In 1980,
that's what I thought.
Like a public access thing?
That's what I thought, yeah, because Martha Quinn was the original VJ.
Really?
She was the first VJ.
Hmm.
Yep.
What a little cutie, too.
So, and she's still around today. I mean, you know, she's still, you know, is a, you know, personality. I don't know if she actually does radio or anything of that nature. I'm not really 100%
sure. She probably
does
a little bit of everything.
But, you know... yeah, it was begun that far back. It just didn't get syndicated. I guess that's the proper term, worldwide or nationwide anyway, until I think 1983, maybe something like that. But we didn't get it around here. I didn't think until 1985 because Dire Straits, I remember seeing Money for Nothing. I remember seeing Roger Daltrey from The Who, his solo album Under Raging Moon. He had a couple of, singles from that one, and I remember seeing the videos for those. I would say 84, 85 is when we finally got access to MTV here.
Yeah, I wish I had those. I wish I could find those tapes
right
somewhere. I have the live, when Live Aid was a thing, we taped that.
Yeah, I remember watching some of that
because I left I left those VHS tapes here for a minute.
Right,
I have to find a way to play those too because. I don't have a VHS player.
I wonder if Van Halen played with Sammy at, or maybe they weren't ready yet. No.
What year was Live Aid? 85?
It was 85. But I don't know if they played, if they had gotten Sammy to replace Dave yet, or if they were just about to.
That was right in the window.
Because 5150, I thought, was an 86 album. I thought it was released in April of 86.
That makes, well...
I have to look it up, perhaps, to make sure.
I can't,
but if
actually.
My memory is correct, I'm almost positive 5150 was an 86 album because of David Lee Roth's Eat 'Em and Smile. Now, Dave might have actually had his album out way before that, but I'm not... Again, I can't really be certain. So my memory is a little fuzzy.
See, 5150, March 24th, 1986.
March of 86, okay.
So you were right there in the...
Almost there.
So April, it was probably playing around a lot.
Yeah.
That's another thing about Brett. He's got a phenomenal memory for windows of time like that.
Yeah, you know, the older I get, you know, the more fuzzy sometimes I might be on certain details, but I try to be sharp as much as I can.
Yes, you do. And we're not... You know, well, especially at our age, we're not really starting to be known for our memory.
Yeah, we're now, so we're hitting our, you know, here, folks, and
to
you know,
edit that shit out.
Oh, whatever, dude.
Okay, so we've touched on OU812 and a couple other things. I never thought we were going to get to Live Aid today, but
yeah, you know.
We did talk about Eat 'Em and Smile just a little bit. So that was 86, you say?
Yeah,
I'm gonna
I
go
mean,
with your memory because you seem pretty sure.
I want to say that it's possible that that album might have been released in December of 85, but I'm not 100% certain again on that one, unless it was January, February. Or it's possible it might have just followed 5150's release. I can't remember exactly. But all I remember is, you know, reading in some of the music magazines of the day that I used to buy, like Circus and Hip Parader and Cream and Rolling Stone.
Those things, yes.
All that kind of stuff. They were like, well, do you like Dave or do you like Van Halen? Because, you know, it was split camps. You know, Dave left the band.
Yeah.
You know, but I like both. I mean, I didn't choose between one or the other. I didn't think one was better than the other. I thought what Dave had musically rivaled what Van Halen had because he had Steve Vai on guitar. You know, young up-and-coming guitarist had cut his teeth with Frank Zappa.
Yeah,
another favorite of ours that we'll no doubt talk about later on.
Opportunity, I'm sure.
Absolutely. We'll definitely have a Zappa hour. But anyway... Billy Sheehan on bass, phenomenal bassist,
yes.
Kind of a hired gun. He had played with UFO when they needed a bass player in a few years before that. He was in Mr. Big, which was an amazing you know, band of musicians, hard rock band, but you know, incredible players. Greg Bissonette was the drummer.
Yeah, that's,
you know,
right. Greg Bissonette.
Excellent, excellent percussionist. Rivals Alex Van Halen, of course. Billy Sheehan, I think, was better than Michael Anthony, to be honest with you.
As a player?
Absolutely.
Absolutely. I saw Billy Sheehan come in. I worked at a club in New York City, and I don't know who he was with that night. I think it was just a three-piece. Oh, it was Niacin.
Mm.
And it was him and Dennis Chambers and John Novello, I think, on keys.
Amazing.
Dude, just a mind-blowing show. And the thing was, the way the stage was set up at this venue, I could sit right behind the entrance to the stage, and the drums were just set up right there. So I literally sat there. They were there, I think, for two nights, two shows a night. So I sat behind Dennis Chambers and watched him work for four straight shows on two solid nights, man. And, dude, that guy plays drums so fucking loud.
Mm.
I mean, good God. They didn't need to. The only reason they put mics on his drums was to record him, because you could hear him everywhere in the room.
No, yeah.
Over all the PA and everything. I mean, these guys didn't sing, so they were just a three-piece. But, man, they're incredible.
He's
nice.
A powerhouse,
check them out,
man.
If you ever get a chance. Phenomenal. I guess that would have been around 2000, 2001, 2002 that I was in there. And
wonder who Dennis Chambers. I know he's a much sought-after session drummer, and you know, that list runs on and on, but wonder who he... I want to say he was in a band configuration. He had to have been.
I think he cut his teeth with James Brown.
Okay. That would make sense.
Yeah. Because, like, the funny thing is, what's the guy's name, the drummer from Dave Matthews Band? Carter Beauford.
Uh-huh.
So he and Dennis were friends growing up.
Okay.
And, like, they're always, you know, in competition with one another, playing together.
Hmm.
And, like, Dennis, like, caught some gig with, like, James Brown, or just caught a gig somewhere and, like, just took off and went. And Carter Beauford, who is obviously just as talented a player, you know, has got his own distinct style, but those guys have been friends their whole lives. And,
right.
Like, you know, Dennis's career took off 20 years, almost, you know, to the day, I think.
Oh, God, yeah.
And then Carter hit with, you know, Dave Matthews Band, of course, and then, you know, I'm pretty sure he went on to do some other work after that. Although I am not aware, nor do I celebrate Carter Beauford.
Not yet, anyway.
Not yet, anyway. Yeah. Yeah, maybe I'll get there one day. Who the hell knows? Oh, so what else have you been listening to this week?
Well, of course, you know, while we're on the subject of drummers, but...
Oh, nice segue.
But yeah, you know, Tony Williams is somebody that I've actually just acquired. Not the original Lifetime, which had John McLaughlin on you know, lead guitar, and trying to remember exactly who the bass player was. And it's slipping my mind. I can't remember who the bassist was. It's not Stanley Clark. Stanley Clark was in Return to Forever.
Well, let's just go over here to the magical computing machine.
But, yeah, you know, sorry, folks. My sharp-knifed memory is failing me right now.
What's the album again?
Well, actually, not on this one. The bass player on the album that I'm talking about, which was his new Lifetime, not the original Lifetime, but the Tony Williams new Lifetime, after the first one fell apart, which also included Jack Bruce from Cream. But anyway,
really?
New Lifetime, you know, heralded the entrance of Alan Holdsworth, a guitarist extraordinaire who passed away last year, unfortunately. And the bass player was actually a Motown bass player.
Yeah, and just to give you a moment of time,
sought after.
If you're listening back to this stuff and you're just wondering, you know, our frame of reference, where we are, and you know, the overall scheme of timelines and things, whatever, is the big word in the news this week was shithole. So,
yes, by our wonderful president.
Let's not talk about politics.
Yeah, let's not do that. Anywho, back to it. Tony Newton is the electric bass player who came from the Motown era of music, and was actually incorporated into this latest reformation of Tony's lifetime project. Bruce Botnick, former Doors engineer and co-producer, produced and engineered this particular album called Believe It. And pretty extraordinary, you know, parallel there, you know, former Doors engineer, you know, producing a jazz fusion record. So pretty cool. I also got Mahavishnu Orchestra's first album, Intermounting Flame, which, of course, John McLaughlin, after playing with Miles Davis on the Bitches Brew sessions, decided to form his own group. And features Jan Hammer on keyboards, who later on became famous for the Miami Vice soundtrack. But Billy Cobham was drummer on that particular first lineup of Mahavishnu Orchestra. And of course, Billy Cobham, another fantastic drummer, went on to release the phenomenal Spectrum album, which Jan Hammer plays on as well.
What album are you into this week?
And, well, I was talking about Tony Williams' lifetime, but I was also listening to Mahavishnu Orchestra. The Intermounting Flame is the name of the record. And I was just talking about the musicians involved on that. So, moving a little fast here, but hey, that is kind of my nature. So, checking those things out. There's another parallel that I'm going to get into here.
A little bit of Intermounting Flame here.
A little bit of Intermounting Flame with the phenomenal guitar work of John McLaughlin.
I figured we got this thing set up. May as well make use of it here.
Also has a violinist feature. And the violinist is Jerry Goodman. Rick Laird is the bassist. Listen to Jan Hammer's keyboard work. It's really quite extraordinary. Some people, you know, could possibly draw some parallels with Chick Corea at the time. Chick, I think, is a little bit more... Chick has a little bit more progression to him, I think, than Jan does. But Jan's very good. Of course, he merged with Jeff Beck in the mid-late 70s, and they did some things together.
Hard to beat Chick Corea in the 70s. Real fucking
hard to beat Chick, period. Chick's pretty phenomenal.
True.
Keyboardist. Although Herbie Hancock is just as equal.
And yeah, different.
A little different style.
Yeah, but, and probably...
they both played with Miles, though.
Yeah, who else was playing with Miles in the 70s?
Keith Jarrett.
Keith Jarrett, that's
Keith
who
Jarrett
I'm thinking of.
Played with him for a little while. He actually started playing electric piano. He was... Primarily just an acoustic player.
He did, and I know I've played it for you at some point, but he
did... The Cone Concert.
The Cone Concert.
Yes.
It was a completely improvised
Beautiful.
Piece of music, and man, you want to talk about something fantastic. If there's a link for it somewhere here on YouTube, I'll link that in the description.
Absolutely.
Because that's where we're going to start, Britness. We're going to start over there on the old YouTube.
Oh, I intend. Have every intention for us to do that.
Yeah,
is the goal.
We're gonna start there. Actually,
I mean, we're having fun with this, but we're serious with it too. So
we're seriously having fun.
That's right, serious fun. There you go, serious fun. That's what it's all about. Yeah. Great term there. Great phrase, man. Serious fun. Yeah. I think I was actually honest with you that comes from Luther Grosvenor, guitarist in Mott the Hoople. There's a documentary DVD that I own, the story of Mott the Hoople. Of course, it's the Ballad of Mott the Hoople.
Of course, we've gotten drunk and watched it several times.
Absolutely. And he was quoted as saying that. He's like, I've always loved the term serious fun. And that's what he talked about when he was on tour with Mott, was that he had serious fun. So
I like that. Actually.
That's a good reference. Yeah.
Yeah. We're seriously having fun.
Seriously having fun. So anyway, back to, Mahavishnu, Billy Cobham, Jan Hammer. You know, we're talking about the drummers of the fusion world. We're drawing parallels here. Also bringing up another band that I was listening to this week, the album UK, which I was enlightening you with, the super group that was formed of the former King Crimson rhythm section before King Crimson imploded in the mid-70s. Robert Fripp decided to end things. So Bill Bruford and John Wetton decided to join forces with Eddie Jobson, and Alan Holdsworth got involved. So we have Alan Holdsworth that was just mentioned with Tony Williams' New Lifetime, and now he's involved in this project called UK. Progressive here. We're going from fusion to progressive rock here, but UK certainly has elements of fusion as well, with the keyboard work of Eddie Jobson, who was fresh out of, again, playing with Frank Zappa at that point, when UK started. He had just ended a stint with Frank Zappa. So once again, there's a parallel of Zappa here. Quite extraordinary. UK later on, actually, you know, the debut album was kind of a one-off project, because once they went on tour, Jobson didn't seem to care much for Alan Holdsworth's style and what he was bringing to the live performances. So
I actually think I found a little bit of this.
Yes.
In the Dead of the Night?
Yes, In the Dead of Night. Yes. Looks like at least Holdsworth is
Bill Bruford
on this video. Bill Bruford, of course, is featured here. I don't know if this is live or if they're actually just miming to this. Sounds like it's a live John Wetton vocal. It's a very old, grainy video.
Yeah, you can tell by the sound that this is... This is from the late 70s, probably early 80s.
Oh, no, this had to have been done whenever the album was released. It was probably a promotional video. Back in those days, they called it promotional videos. Sounds like it's live, though, because the vocals are a little shaky. Eddie Jobson sounds like he's actually singing some backing vocals. Didn't realize he was a backup singer. Thought Eddie was more of just a keyboardist, violinist, musicianist. Very much a progressive supergroup. That first album. Afterwards, things kind of imploded once they came off the road. Holdsworth left. Bruford, I think, wasn't too happy about Holdsworth being ousted. And I believe Holdsworth might have been in Bruford.
It's always a pissing contest.
So, but however, they replaced Bill Bruford with another Frank Zappa, and Terry Bozzio was actually drummer in UK for their next album that they did and tour.
Have you seen his new drum kit?
I have.
I don't
think I have. I think I have.
You couldn't fit the setup in this room.
Right. That's how ridiculous it is.
It's tall. Like because there's a bar that goes across the top.
Isn't it like a drum set within a drum set?
It's,
or like several.
Hold on here.
Because I want to say it's pretty ridiculous, and naturally Terry is the type of drummer that I'm sure he plays every single one, but how ridiculous of a drum set do you need to have? I mean, you know, you have Alex Van Halen's double basses that are literally double basses. That's pretty fucking awesome right there.
Here, dude, there's four kick drums on this fucking thing. Look at this.
Oh yeah,
that's from the other side.
Oh yeah,
and he's got like all kinds of like front. You can see from the back here, he's got all kinds of like
dude
pedals and stuff. And oh, you can't see real well on that one. But yeah, there's all
he
kinds.
He must
of...
be an octopus or something, dude. Because I mean, you would have to have, you know, that's pretty insane. I mean, are we talking 78 pieces of percussion there?
I mean, look at all the pedals he's got on the floor there.
I mean, do they have them counted out exactly?
Two,
how many
three,
drums?
3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. That 10, 11, like 12 or 14 pedals there on the ground, all for, you know, different hi-hats and...
Sure,
bass drums. He's got remotes going out to other bass drums, and like everything he's got is pitched.
And not to mention MIDI. He's probably got all kinds of crazy...
Actually, I think it's mostly
computer
acoustic.
Computer programs, or... Oh, is it?
I think it's mostly acoustic, okay. But I'll try to... Whenever I'm working on the video thing, this gives me something to...
Yeah,
try to flash up there for people to look at, and this isn't like your a rock and roll drum kit. This is like
no.
This is like the kind of drum kit where it's like, you know, I'm going to do some serious percussion work.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's this
absolutely.
Is, you know, everything looks like it's pitched and it's just, it's crazy. It's crazy. I could lose my fucking mind behind a kit like that. Although it looks like it's got the same finish, right? They're DW. Oh, no, they're a little different. I see now.
Slightly different.
Yeah, I also have a set of DWs.
But like I said, Alex Van Halen's, like one of his drum kit setups, he's got the quadruple bass drums, but it looks like he's got a bass drum hitched into a bass drum shell, like double time, like, you know, I think it was the 82 tour where he actually did that. There's photos out there of it or whatever, of just how excessive, you know, things can be sometimes. Like, how much louder do you want to be, you know? Because we were talking about the whole John Bonham connection with him as being the successor, perhaps, from once Bonham, you know, unfortunately met his quick demise at the beginning of towards the end of 1980. Alex Van Halen maybe carrying the torch, perhaps.
As a hard hitter, something like that?
I would say probably one of the closest... Phil Collins, you know, Genesis aside for that time period.
Also from that side of the pond, too.
Playing on Robert Plant's Principle of Moments album. He is the drummer on the song In the Mood, which was the hit single from that album.
Just hear so much of the room that way. Oh, go back to it, right?
I heard that. But Phil Collins' drum attack on In the Mood is extraordinary. Definitely Bonham-esque. And,
love that song.
You know,
let's get a little of that going. Hold on.
Phil Collins, unfortunately, you know, during that time became more of a pop star and didn't really, you know, yes, he cut his teeth in Genesis as a drummer, of course, especially during the Gabriel years. And then, of course, ascended once Gabriel left and assumed the vocals and kind of the artistic control after a few albums. But Phil Collins is a great drummer. And unfortunately, I don't think he's ever gotten back to that space, which... is kind of a shame.
This song is I think pretty fantastic.
Oh, it's killer.
This is
absolute killer. It's definitely close to what maybe perhaps Zeppelin could have accomplished if they'd have stayed together. They could have done something like this easily.
It definitely had a
the guitar tone that his guitarist used.
I was gonna say
very Page-esque.
Lot of the production quality was very Led Zeppelin. Mm-hmm. Very Led Zeppelin.
Absolutely.
On this tune.
I mean, of course, you hear the drum beat. It's, you know, obvious.
Drum production is, especially obvious. That kick drum.
But the way he hits it, it's very Bonham-esque.
Yeah, and that's Phil Collins?
That's Phil Collins.
Phil Collins, ladies and gentlemen. People break dancing in this video.
Well, you got to remember, this is like 83, 84. So when this song came out, I mean, it was, you know, that was kind of, you know,
break
dancing was still pretty hip, man.
I'll give this guy break dancing one thing. He's dressed an awful lot like, what's his name from the Stones? The football pants on.
Rod Stewart or Mick Jagger?
Mick Jagger.
Mick Jagger, yeah, because Mick Jagger
run around with the football
the 81
pants on.
The 81 tour, he did have, you know, he changed in various costumes, but he wound up wearing with knee pads.
Hey, Mick, what'd you go to school for?
Yeah.
And all this, fashion days on.
Yeah, exactly. But he'd wear a football jersey with those fucking things, dude, and sometimes he'd have his shirt off, and that's all he'd be wearing, but, you know.
Sorry, I was laughing too hard to try to do a serious Mick imitation.
But yeah, you know, going back and you know, this takes us back again to the MTV angle too. I mean, you know, this is very much of its time
of marketing video. Yeah,
you know, back in the day when videos were actually more important than the radio.
Video was everything.
Video was everything back in those days. There was so much emphasis on that. You know, and of course nowadays nobody gives two shits about it anymore. But you know, I You know, I think we all kind of got caught up in that. I mean, I was definitely interested in it for a little while there, and then, you know, kind of lost its flavor after a certain point. I've never been a huge television advocate. You know, I'm more of a self-induced type of guy. You know, I prefer to watch DVDs of my choice, of my choosing. I do have quite a collection there as well.
Shit, yeah.
Besides my CD collection, which is ridiculous. Before that, I had an extraordinary cassette and vinyl collection. I still have vinyl. Don't really utilize it. Haven't gotten into the vinyl boom resurgence of the last 15 years. Number one, I just don't want to waste my money again on a medium that I already exhausted my expenses on. So I refuse to buy back into vinyl. Plus, I really don't think that it's something that's going to sustain itself. There's a lot of audio addicts out there, of which I'm not really too particularly anal about my audio. I just want it to have a decent mix. I don't like the brick walling. You know, some of the albums that get remixed and remastered and that sort of a thing, I get a little pissed off about the bass boost frequency, the loudness wars, clipping that comes through the mix, which you can hear on albums as much.
Well, some of that might far. Be studio. Anyway.
Metallica, Death Magnetic, you know, was accused of just being overtly distorted. Rush's Vapor Trails, they actually went so far to remix that album because fans complained so much, and even the band didn't like the way it was mixed originally. So that was part of the loudness wars.
So, you have to imagine in those days that it was, you know, you didn't have a say about who mixed or mastered your album. It was just, you know.
I think they went with the times just for the sake of going with it. I think that's a lot of the case, because you'll find more and more that a lot of people prefer to access. Some of them prefer to access the new vinyl over the CD. You know, to me, it's more of a preference. I stick with CDs. I'm going to continue to buying them until they no longer manufacture them. I was just telling, of course, the other day when I was at a local store in the mall.
Phil.
One of the, I'm sorry, Phil. Yes, Phil. Philbert. I was telling Philbert the other day.
Philbert?
That I was talking to a store associate at one of the retailers around the area, and he said cassettes were coming back, for God's sakes. And I just looked at him in disbelief. I said, "You can't be serious."
Of course he's serious, because you have to consider that that shit, like the nowadays. We talked about this then. Nowadays, right. They kind of have a better handle on, you know, what the medium is that people are going with. Everything's going to digital. So, you know, yeah, of course you've got some audiophiles who are really into the whole, you know, I have a turntable and I put this needle on and I am changing this sound of this every single time I listen to it, because they are. They're wearing it down a little bit.
You know, there's a lot of people that swear by the 5.1 mixes, which are DVD audio.
Yeah, five to one
things
surround.
Things of that nature. Yeah. There was that rumbling around. That started back in 2010, I believe. Bands like Jethro Tull and Emerson, Lake and Palmer and King Crimson, you know, progressive, you know, 70s rock bands, reissuing their catalogs with the DVD audio option. And, you know, it's a bit pricey.
To buy something that you've already got.
You know, most of these releases that they do feature in 5.1 are geared towards people that have home theater systems that can support these, you know, features. I myself could care less about that. I, you know, if it's remastered in a single disc update form, or if you want to add a bonus disc for a deluxe edition of either a live material never been heard of, or outtakes or alternate mixes of said material on the album, I'm fine with that. But I'm not interested in the DVD audio. I don't want to spend $40 on a reissued title from something that I already have from a previous version.
That's the thing that always kind of chaps me is,
well, they know they can get away with it.
You're spending money on things that you...
titles you've already owned three times, perhaps.
Yeah.
You know, in my case, with Led Zeppelin, I have vinyl copy of Presence. You know, I know back in the day I had a cassette copy of it, and I've at least replaced a CD copy of Presence twice since they did. Jimmy Page did the remastering. Well, yeah, because, you know, and then it brings to mind, well, I've already made them four times rich because I'm replacing this copy again. So I get a little disgusted and perturbed. Van Halen, we're getting back to Van Halen. They remastered the Roth catalog a few years back, but what chapped my ass about it is that some of the acts, at least when they do a remastering campaign of the back catalog, they're going to offer bonus material. Van Halen were cheeky as fuck about it and did not do that at all. They basically just remastered the six albums with Roth in the same form. The quality sounds better. Because my old copy of Diver Down, you know, from the original CD version is awful. I have to practically crank it up to 50 to get it to sound halfway decent. And so I know that the newly remastered version of Diver Down is going to sound that much better. But what chaps my ass is that they didn't really do it for the fans properly. They didn't go the extra mile in offering bonus material. Van Halen 2.
Get yourself a drink there.
I had to wet my whistle, folks. Van Halen 2, the album itself, I just played it the other day. It's 31 minutes and 10 seconds long.
That's not very long.
By today's standards, that's like
half an album.
that's almost an EP.
Yeah.
Basically. So the recording practices have changed. But with that, they could have certainly warranted. Throat's getting a little dry, folks. Sorry about that. But they could have certainly warranted bonus material on that particular release just to round out enough material for a CD because you have at least 80 minutes on a compact disc. Whereas vinyl, you only had at least 45 minutes. What was I talking about again? Was I talking about Van Halen? Yes, I was talking about Van Halen and the fact that they reissued their back catalog with Roth and they didn't take the opportunity of hooking up the fans with bonus tracks, live material from the time period on said albums.
Whoa, that's different.
They didn't do any of that stuff. And, you know, even Jimmy Page, you know, as, you know, devious as he is with Led Zeppelin's remasters over the years and recycling the same stuff, and it's like, oh, but it's you know, newly remastered in this format and blah blah blah, he did actually offer alternate takes. Some of them are a little devious, again, the way that he is, because he's so and rightfully so, because he is largely the creator of Led Zeppelin, so he's allowed to approach it any way he wants. But Van Halen didn't even bother to do that. They still haven't really truly remastered the Hagar CDs, which again, OU812 does sound good. However, I do have to crank it a little more than most of your standardized CDs nowadays that are, again, not so much loudness oriented, but they do have a bit of a volume boost whenever you put them into play.
Well, I didn't realize this chair is squeaking.
You do now.
Damn
get,
it.
Get a job, just watch out.
now that I want it to squeak, it won't.
Squeak.
Squeak. I've had a couple of beers.
You get a little saucy here. Yeah. I'm being a teetotaler. My friend here is being a...
Yeah, normally it's the other way around.
He's being a beer sipper, which is fine.
I'm just sipping a couple
sipping
beers.
Sipping a beer on a Sunday
afternoon
late
here.
Late early evening. And
sitting around,
you know,
bullshitting about this, that, and the other thing, as
that's
you like to
doing.
Say.
That's what we're doing. That's how we do it.
Bullshitting. Get some of these ideas out there because my man Britt's got some good takes on this shit. And I feel like I need to share it with the world. And I know I have the gumption to do it. And to the knee oil to kick him in the ass to get it going.
That's right. And that's how we compliment each other.
Or, huh?
Yeah. Exactly. Anyway.
You got me coughing.
Anyway, back to the airing of the frustrations with the Van Halen remasters.
The airing of the grievances.
It's the airing of the grievances. That's right.
Festivus is over. We got a year, bro.
Nah, man. Festivus never ends.
That's right.
It's just one long fest.
They say Christmas is every day if you do it right. So I guess so. It's Festivus.
True. Yeah. But yeah, you know, eventually, hopefully, you know, Eddie and Alex will get on the fucking train and do it right, and give something back to the fans. I think that would be phenomenal because
lots of
other bands have done it already. I mean, you know, the Kinks have done it, Black Sabbath's done it, you know, and you know, what's out there isn't terrible. You know, I have some of the Sabbath remasters. I have the first album, you know, and they all have two discs. Andy Pierce is the remix engineer who was famous for doing Uriah Heep's back catalog not too long ago. And there was somebody else that he did remasters for him, and people were really happy with because he doesn't do the over compression. He doesn't do the overtly bass boost and the loudness technique or whatever. Pierce is a really good mix engineer for that, understanding the sensibilities of some of the material that he's working with, specifically from the 70s, of course, because they only had so much technology to work with.
Mm.
So if you have good masters to work with, you're going to get a decent remix.
Yeah, you're gonna be able to actually do something with it,
right?
And see that, and that's.
But the ones that are in shitty form, depending on who it is,
shithole, please.
You know, I mean, even you know, take for example, Giles Martin. You know, George Martin's son. You know, did a remix campaign for the Beatles' Hollywood Bowl performances,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And that finally came out. He did a pretty good job with it. I actually enjoyed it. He tried to take out as much audience noise as he could. But, you know, unfortunately, those are two track that he was working with.
Yeah, it's there's only so much you can do, especially with two tracks.
1964, 1965, you know, that was all that you worked with. You didn't really have, you might have had four tracks at a proper recording studio. But when those shows were recorded live at those locations at the Hollywood Bowl, they only had so much to work with in those days. So the audience bleed is deafening. You know, from when his father originally, you know, had worked on the tapes and it was released in 1977, Giles got a chance to update a technology, of course, to work with it.
Is it Giles or Giles?
I think it's Giles Martin.
I don't know. I'm asking you. I shouldn't.
I'm pretty sure it's Giles Martin.
I shouldn't ask you because you don't know.
The proper pronunciation.
Yeah, when you say, I think, you don't fucking know.
Yeah, but that's part of my authoritative opinion.
Well,
so.
All right, this is what we're here for.
That's what I like.
This is what we're here for.
Right.
So, all right, so we've been down through the Halen, been back and forth through the Halen, actually. It's mostly the Van Halen show.
Yeah, which is,
at least,
you know,
more the Van Hagar than anything else. We haven't really talked a whole lot about the early stuff, other than, you know, that's the stuff that they've now remastered.
Yeah. I mean, first and foremost, I will always be a David Lee Roth fan of Van Halen. To me, that's the definitive voice of the band. I do like Sammy, but
see, I don't
Sammy's
look at
always going to be second to me because Dave put across so much presence with his personality. I mean, Dave is the ultimate front man. I mean, you know, we can talk about, you know, front men, you know, from David Bowie to Freddie Mercury to...
I think you're forgetting about Dr. Roxo.
Who's that? Dr. Roxo? Who the fuck is that? Is that a fictional character? Are you mocking me?
No, from what I understand, Dr.
Roxo.
Don't
mock me, Phil.
Do you remember the it was the Cartoon Network, the metal band. Metalocalypse.
Metalocalypse. Yeah.
So
yeah, yeah,
there
yeah.
was a character in the show that was called Dr. Roxo, who was this clown who just, you know, went around fucking acting like a jerk and snorting up cocaine.
Okay.
Apparently, the character is based on Diamond Dave.
I could see that. I mean, I could see that. I mean, Dave is... Well, Dave was obnoxious. I mean, you know, over the years, of course, and I mean...
Was?
He is in his 60s.
Was?
But, well, he's always been a flamboyant, you know, character, of course. I mean, that's
nothing against flamboyance.
That's just the way that... just the way that his personality was. Especially with the history of you know, Eddie and Alex, you know, kind of chafing with him because his personality and everything. The problem is that, you know, like it or not, when they get together, they always make millions of dollars. I mean...
Nothing wrong with that.
You know, you can't deny it. I mean, you know, people, you know, kind of knock on a little bit of the Live at Tokyo Dome release that came out a few years ago and saying how Dave totally, you know, changes his vocal style for that record. I re-listened to it the other night or whatever. You know, it's not that bad, really. I think it's actually good. I think it's fresh that he changes some of the phrasings on some of the songs. You know... some people say that he sings it in far too high of a register or whatever, but I honestly think he's just trying to give his all performance into these songs. You know, people accuse the live record they'd made with Sammy live right here, right now, is far too much studio overdubbing was going on. Even Hagar, I think, intimated that in his autobiography about the recording of it, saying that he basically had to replace all of his vocal tracks in the studio for that record. Wow. So it's not really a live album, you see.
Well, the instruments are live.
Well, no, I mean, according, you know, there's an awful lot of tinkering going on, supposedly.
Well, that's what you do for a live
album. Yeah,
well,
but you don't
that used
replace
to be,
everything.
That used to be what you did for a live album.
I mean...
Otherwise, you just record it in the studio and you put
the late 70s. Yeah, I mean, there was a lot of, you know, Kiss was famous for, you know, actually not really truly releasing live albums.
Hell, in the end of Alive 2, they actually put a bunch of studio songs.
Yeah, Alive 2 was actually more probably worse than the first Alive. The first Alive, they maintained, was very little polishing in the studio afterwards. It was pretty much what you heard was what you got.
Yeah, they got the old air stroke
but,
from me.
You know, and, you know, there's several other live albums of the day or whatever, but UFO's Strangers in the Night. There's also... it was just right on my brain at the time.
That was how you did everything back then, though.
Thin Lizzy's Live and Dangerous. Judas Priest's Unleashed in the East has often been referred to as Unleashed in the Studio because there was so much overdubbing going on. That album was recorded in Japan, but yeah. they call it Unleashed in the Studio. Yeah, it's pretty cool. Because a lot of people, I mean, there's a lot of Amazon reviews that you know, point that one out. So anyhow, you know, the art of, you know, live records back in those days or whatever. I mean, you know, the Tokyo Dome performance, though, supposedly is minimal and is a straight performance. So, but like it or not, you know, even though Michael Anthony got ousted when you know, Eddie's son came in to play bass, and it took a while to get, you know,
Wolfgang, please.
Took a while to get Wolfgang to get broken into the band or whatever, but I think he's done a really good job. I think he does an excellent spot, you know, kind of taking Michael Anthony's shoes.
Not easy shoes to fill. I mean, you talk about somebody who sings, you know, in the register of a castrati.
Yeah, but I mean, you know, he and his father, you know, listening to the... You know, playbacks of that Tokyo Dome concert on certain songs like, let's see, what about...
Did you say he and his father?
He and his father. Well, yeah, Eddie and Wolfgang.
Okay, Wolfgang.
Yeah. Eddie and Wolfgang sang in harmonies with David. Unchained, you know, is a fine reference of them hitting those harmonies. Jump is pretty good. You know, can't really knock them too much. They also do the buried nugget Women in Love from the second album, and actually hit those harmonies really well. So, you know, Mike not being involved, and of course, you know, as we all know, Mike got involved with Chickenfoot and Sammy and having Joe Satriani on guitar and then Chad Smith from the Chili Peppers on drums.
Right.
You know, they put that project
together.
What
about the Chickenfoot?
Yeah. So there's these all these things going on to bide their time with the Van Halen brothers, you know, being, you know, Eddie sometimes, you know, is a dickhead, I think. You know, I mean, I think he's, you know, and I wouldn't doubt, and that was something else that I was bringing up earlier, of course, you know, with the bout of inactivity right now, Wolfgang supposedly is going to be releasing his first solo album, but it's been pushed back and pushed back. It was originally supposed to be out next month, I think, but it's been pushed back again. David Lee Roth, what does the future hold? Will they make another studio album with him?
See, that's a good question.
That's a real good question. Different kind of truth. You know, it's been purported, and of course, they didn't hold any punches, you know, or withhold any information. You know, they basically said that they were, you know, cleaning the vaults out, and most of the songs that appear on it are from, you know, way back in the day, discarded numbers that they, you know, dug out, polished up, you know, finished the lyrics, finished the guitar solos, whatever it was. You know, I mean, they naturally, I would think they retract all these numbers for the quartet to play. So I don't think there was any accusations of using Michael Anthony bass parts or anything like that. Almost positive Dave recorded fresh vocals, not using old vocals, recycled, that kind of thing.
I see. So they're just basically, they're getting the old stuff and they're making it new. Dusting it off.
That's what they did with Different Kind of Truth.
Are they retracking this stuff, or are they using some old tracks and new tracks?
Well, that's the thing. I don't know how much new material actually they wrote for the record, or if they actually brought all these songs from various sessions.
Oh, I'm talking just strictly from a point of production. I mean, are they taking Eddie's guitar parts from the 70s and slapping on, you know, a bass part from the, you know, from this decade?
To my understanding, I think that they were using those as reference points, but ultimately re-recording
it. Everything. Okay.
Yes, re-recording it and making it fresh.
That would make the most sense because, I mean, you're talking about, you know, 40 years ago. Technology has come a fucking far fucking way. I mean, everything is digital now.
Oh, yeah.
You know, everything was, you know.
It was analog back then. It was, I mean, everything was
magnetic
on,
to
you
tape.
Know,
so
everything was on tape, and you know, when you edited, you had to take a razor blade and cut out tape.
Yeah,
and then splice it back together.
Imagine the poor bastard who went out and recorded everything, and you know, got everything down on tape and got a good mix going, and is really happy with everything, and goes and he takes the tapes and goes to walk out of the studio and he sets them down on top of a speaker.
Right.
A speaker is basically a magnet.
Right.
You know, and you're talking about magnetic stuff on tape.
Mm-hmm.
So you set a tape on top of a speaker, you're asking for fucking trouble.
Well, in terms of editing, for example, I mean, you know, we can use a fine example with the primitive technology, Yes's Tales from Topographic Oceans. That record it was ridiculously hard to edit and cut tape because the instrumental sections were so long and lumbering. They had tape, they literally would run tape around the room, because they didn't have any other resources to do so.
Whereas nowadays, it's just a, you know,
it's a program.
Yeah, it's digital.
Pro Tools, you just click into it, which, of course, later on, yes, Trevor Rabin was a consultant for Pro Tools.
Of course.
Different era of Yes, but, you know, nonetheless, it was the 80s Yes that he was involved in. But Trevor Rabin, technology, you know, technological,
easy for you to say.
Technological extraordinary.
And I'm drunk.
Yeah, I mean, drinking. Oh, my God, man. What the hell?
Eh, whatever.
But, yeah, I mean, so it just goes to show that, you know, there's just, with the evolutions of things, sometimes the old school way is, you know, painstaking, but, you know, it was probably worth it in the end also. But anyway, so not to get too far off the beaten path. Back to, will Dave hang around? Will Van Halen do another studio record with him? I would like to think yes, but it's hard to say. I mean, there was a rumor last year going through some of the music sites that they're going to reunite with Sammy again. But just because Sammy and Eddie spoke briefly or something like that, and they hadn't spoken for a very long time, I think it was to wish him a happy birthday or something like that.
I mean, they did spend a number of years traveling in the bubble together, so
yeah,
you know, that you gotta think that there's still some kind of friendship there.
They reunited in 2004, unfortunately, and they did a summer tour, but unfortunately, at the end of the tour is when the nail went into the coffin, and Sammy basically, you know, couldn't stand Eddie's drinking. Eddie's drinking accelerated to the point of him not wanting to be around him. Before that, it was his cigarette smoking. Matter of fact, he and Mike would ride in separate limos after a certain point because Eddie was such a chain smoker.
Mm.
Of course, I think Eddie has since, I don't know if he's ever dropped the habit or not, because I know he had tongue cancer scare for a little bit there. And then, of course, it turned out to be, I think, benign is the proper term.
Yeah. So, take them both out. I don't fucking need them.
Right. Little Dennis Leary there talking about John Wayne getting cancer. Said he'd grow lungs, take his lungs out and grow gills and breathe like a fish. But anyhow, unfortunately, there was a huge falling out there. And wonder if that might repeat itself with Dave. I would like to think not, that they've gotten over all that stuff. They're mature enough to not repeat those mistakes.
Yeah, but still, you have to understand, though. I mean, there was basically, it's the same band, same name, same, mostly the same members, but you have a different front man.
Well, actually,
and there's a lot of
family.
Because
Wolfie's in there, and you got Alex and Eddie, so you got the uncle and the father, and then you have the nephew or the son. You know, and then you have Dave, who is the original singer. So, you know, that's a different lineup altogether.
Different
dynamic.
Just across the spectrum of just the two different lead singers, you know, not even considering the stuff that happened on bass guitar, you're talking about, you know, two different, very distinct periods in the band's history.
Oh, yeah.
Where there is just, there's, you know, if you're going to play music from just half your catalog, I mean, that seems counterintuitive to me.
Yeah.
You know, to go out and hit the road and to not play half your fucking catalog. Are you fucking shitting me?
Right.
And I, you know damn well Dave can't hit some of those notes that...
Well, no, but at the same time, Sammy's no spring chicken either. I mean, Sammy is actually about 10 years older than Roth, I think. Sammy's in his 70s now.
Oh, yeah.
Well, so, I mean...
He and Clinton are the same age.
Probably.
President Bill.
Yeah?
Are the same age.
Yeah?
Because there's... I saw...
Really?
Yeah, we'll just not get into politics.
I thought Bill was a little older than that.
No, they're the same age.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay. I mean, you know, as we all know, Sammy cut his teeth with Ronnie Montrose back in the day, being the singer for Montrose. But, of course, Ronnie Montrose passed away a few years ago. But, I mean, Van Halen definitely became more progressive with Sammy. Probably
I really liked. See, and that's the kind of thing that upsets, you know, a fan like me. You know, I love that Dave is back in the band. I love that, you know, they have reunited and they're able to do all the stuff that they stopped doing or didn't do as much of,
mm-hmm.
you know, once Sammy joined the band. But
those progressions, however, I mean, I will point out, you know, 1984, as I've mentioned before, you know, the closing numbers on that album, Girl Gone Bad and House of Pain, more of the progressive side of Van Halen showing. So that was already kind of there anyway. Dave wasn't a big fan of it. Dave was more of keep it simple, let's rock it, let's hook them in, which is admirable. But at the same time, if you get a nice balance of the two, which, for example, I think I would say, you know, would you say Hot for Teacher has some progressive elements? If nothing else, Alex's drumming?
Yeah, I mean, that's the drumming is something that, like, that's never... I'd never heard anything like that before.
Mm-hmm.
Granted, I was fairly young at the time. You know, I was only fourth grade. But, I mean, still to this day, that's fairly distinct stuff. You hear mm-hmm. someone play that beat, you know who it's from and where it's from.
And then, like, you have Drop Dead Legs right before it, which is more of a Bonham-esque.
Yes. Yeah. You know, well, definitely from a drumming standpoint.
Like, I've got a club foot. You
yeah.
know,
just a big, wide open kind of sound,
mm-hmm.
you know. But I mean, that's, you get that all down through the catalog because you got, Cabo Wabo. That's,
Well, yeah,
that's a big open that and Drop Dead Legs.
Phenomenal.
Very similar, more similar than most people would.
Or maybe Black and Blue. Maybe Black and Blue is a little more similar to Drop Dead Legs.
Well,
drumming
as far as the drums,
more simplified.
Yeah, but just like the whole that whole wide open sound where you know there's not playing a lot of notes. It's just a more like, you know, we're going to kick your fucking teeth out right here instead of, you know, instead of just bombard you with notes.
Right.
You know, and that's just any good band does that, goes back and forth between, you know, being able, you know, to exhibit your technical proficiency and at the same time, you know, be able to just, you know, blast, you know, the skin off someone's face.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's merit in both of that, and being able to do both and well, you know, is the mark of a truly great band. And I think Led Zeppelin definitely, or Led Zeppelin, Van Halen, but, well, Zeppelin, obviously. But
oh, yeah.
Van Halen definitely does that.
Well, they took a leaf, of course, from Led Zeppelin, obviously.
Yeah.
I mean, there's no doubt about it. You can hear it in, you know, I mean, Eddie surpasses, of course, Jimmy Page with his style and technique. But
far and away.
And he, of course, he maintained that he was more of a Clapton aficionado when he was learning guitar. He wasn't really a big Page fan, it seemed like. I think he admired Hendrix and probably took some cues from Hendrix, with certain techniques and this, that, and the other. I mean, certainly the finger tapping technique, which he basically immortalized as all guitar players began to copy all that.
Well, it's it was fairly impressive the way he displayed the skill. I mean,
yeah. But I think, you know, like I said, he's more of a Clapton guy, not much a Page, you know, per se or whatever. But Alex's drumming style, I mean, there's no doubt about it. You could certainly hear elements of John Bonham. There's just no doubt about it. Mm-hmm. I mean, he's got that power. And of course, he wanted to surpass Bonham, which I think, I don't know about all that, but he's certainly important. I don't know if his drumming style has progressed, however. It's kind of hard to say. I mean, on Different Kind of Truth, I mean, he's still impeccable. You know, Eddie's guitar playing is top notch. I think that album features a lot of good, both of those elements we just talked about more simplified hard rock, but there's also a touch of progression. The number Chinatown is a very progressive number on that album. Then you have Out of Space, which is just
say Hime Town,
complete Chinatown.
Take me down,
don't let me down, don't let me down. Little SNL skit there, Eddie Murphy did back in the day.
I don't know what brought me to that, but
Hime Town.
Probably that bottle of beer right there, that last one.
Ah, that Jamaican lager.
Yeah.
Oh, Jamaican me crazy. Jamaican me drunk. Or I myself am not going to drink until much, much later this evening. But anyhow.
I don't see you and your arbitrary. Brent has a lot of fucking arbitrary rules when it comes to drinking.
Well, some of that comes with the wife, though, and being married. And if you were married, I think you probably appreciate the, I don't drink until this time because it's okay or whatever, or I'm not going to drink more than this, you know. Anyhow, yes, back to the whole, you know, I mean, once again, we're on a little bit of a Van Halen tangent here, but I would like to think that
tangent has been the whole fucking show.
But I would like to think that they would actually do at least one more record with Dave. I mean, you know, like I said, the guy's not getting any younger. I mean, you know, none of them really are. And, you know, hopefully they don't end it with just the Tokyo Dome, release. Hopefully they put something together special.
It's my hope, too, that they would, you know, get it together long enough to go out with a bang and not with a whimper.
Exactly. You know, and even if they don't complete it with Dave and they do get back with Sammy, which, again, I don't know if that's ever going to really, truly happen.
I think what they should really do at this point, I mean, they've proven that, you know, they don't get along with either one of these guys. Find someone who can do both these.
They tried that with Sharon and that did not work.
Well, I don't think it had so much to do. I think it might have had more to do with the actual person that they got. And
that could be, I mean, that certainly could be. I mean, you know, it was kind of an outside of the box thing. And once again, when I streamed Van Halen 3 with him on it, because I've never owned it, and apparently a lot of the fans are not too fond of it, and rightfully so, because it could be argued that album technically should have been an Eddie Van Halen solo album. However, you know, Mike Anthony's presence is on it, of course, you know, and there's a lot of outside-the-box moments, but there's a few numbers where Sharon sounds so much like Sammy, and it's really disconcerting.
Oh. Wow.
Because if you really wanted that, why did you get rid of, why did you fall out with Sammy then? You should have just kept him.
Well,
you know. However, Sharon
personally,
does
professionally
have,
are two different things, though.
No, of course. But if you're going to emulate your former singer with somebody else, that's kind of counterproductive, in my opinion.
That's not really the way to go.
You know, but we all know that it didn't work out. Unfortunately, it didn't. When we possibly will touch on that one, at some point, maybe another podcast or whatever.
Yeah, another podcast.
You know, where we can focus on off the wall records. Maybe we can do a theme of, you know, bands that tried different singers and failed. You know, because there's certainly enough instances, I think, where that.
Well, I think it's going to do.
Or improve the band, perhaps.
I think it's because my idea for this whole thing, and I'll share this with everybody, is that every time I come out here, I always ask you what you're listening to, and it's always something fucking off the wall from the last time that I spoke to you.
Sometimes I'll listen to the same stuff in one day. I'll listen to punk and fusion in the same breath.
Yeah, you're.
It's pretty crazy.
You're really making my nuts hurt with that shit.
I can't help it, man. It's just, you know, it's whatever hits my fancy, man.
I feel like we've reached the limit of what we can do with at least the Sammy Hagar version of Van Halen.
Please.
However you want to refer to it.
It's the preferred nomenclature, please. Van Hagar.
Right on. Well, we also talked to a little Tony Williams in there, and I really like this.
Yeah.
I was.
I haven't let it all sink in yet, but.
We were listening to this the other night, and I really liked where this went. A lot of this, like the keyboards in this. So if you could take us out with a little of Tony Williams.
Yeah.
All right. So I'm Phil. That's Britt.
I'm Britt.
This is the Britt and Phil Show. Thanks for listening. We hope to do a lot more of this.
Absolutely, y'all.
And keep your nuts dry and your powder fresh.
Yay.